Hi, everybody. I'm PJ Kwong, and I'd like to welcome you to another SGS Live. This is going to be a fascinating conversation around CE marking for construction products for not only today, but tomorrow. And to help me break it down, I am joined by Peter Crucq, Project Engineer for Industries and Environment from SGS Intron in the Netherlands. Welcome, Peter. Thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you, and thank you for having me.
This is going to be a great conversation. I want to remind everybody that we're going to be having a question and answer period at the end of our little interview part here. You are welcome to join in. And we've got lots of people who are going to be coming in to join us for sure. But first, Peter, we're going to be talking about CE marking for construction products. But I want to talk a little bit about you. Can you tell me your background?
Yeah, certainly. I'm Peter Crucq, and I'm currently working for over 15 years at the Dutch SGS Intron affiliate, SGS Intron. And we are concerned with construction products, testing, inspection, and certification of building products. And I've specialized in regulations concerning building products, and in particular, CE marking.
Okay. Talking about CE marking, can you please give me a brief explanation of what CE marking is and when it needs to be applied?
Yes, certainly. CE marking, the best way to think about it is that it's a kind of a product passport for the European Union. So if you apply CE marking correctly, your product can be traded in the whole European Union as long as it conforms to the regulations that are concerned with CE marking.
So whose responsibility is it that a product is CE marked?
It's the primary responsibility of any party that sells a CE marked product. So that will mainly be the manufacturers of construction products, and as well as any party that is involved in the selling process, such as distributors and importers.
Okay, because we're talking about CE marking for construction products, is it necessarily only for construction products?
No, it's not. I myself specialize in construction products, but CE marking is also applicable to various other products, including toys, medical equipment, machinery, and electrical equipment, for instance.
So basically everything that makes our life work.
Yeah, and especially if there are safety concerns. That's very important in CE marking to cover.
It's good to know that it's there. So tell me a little bit about what makes up the contents of a CE mark.
Okay, so in the CE mark, there are basically two types of information. One type of information is the information of the producer and the product, so the identification of the product. And the second part is any performances and that are tested and are necessary to present to anyone who wants to buy a CE marked product.
So basically, I asked the wrong question first. Here's the question we need to talk about. So we're going to take a step back. Yes. What needs to happen, or what do you need to do before a CE mark can be applied to a product?
Well, especially in the case of construction products, there are two pillars under the CE mark. One is to test your product. So there is type testing to establish the performances of the product. And the second part is production quality procedures to make sure that this performance is continuously the same.
So you talked about safety before, and that's certainly front and center on lots of people's minds, including mine. So mm-hmm. Is it correct to say that products with CE marking are safe to use?
In principle, yes. That's certainly the extent, intent of CE marking. It should be taken into account, however, that CE marking only concerns the safety of the construction product and does not say anything about the use of the product. So it has to be fit for use. And there are some examples where this is mismatched. One such example, quite recently, quite tragically, was the Grenfell Towers fire in London, where there were CE marked products, but where the product didn't match the fit for use of the product, if you will, of the building, if you will, sorry.
So that's very interesting to me, because it sounds like with the thousands of construction products that are out there, that CE marking may or may not be the same for each of these construction products. Can you elaborate?
Yes. Well, the basic principles are the same for the products. However, the performances and the level of control are different, and they can vary as widely as construction products can vary. So anything from pavement tiles to traffic signs, you can imagine that they are very different, and they are tested different, and they are controlled differently.
You may not believe this, but I'm actually not an expert in construction products. So are there any other kinds of examples that you can sort of tell me about that illustrate these differences in products?
Yeah, well, maybe I can elaborate a little bit more on pavement tiles versus Great. Traffic lights, because that gives a good example.
Yep.
So pavement tiles are a very low risk product. So they need very few checks, and they are tested on things like strength, whereas traffic lights are a much higher safety risk, because if a traffic light doesn't work, you can have all kinds of accidents. So the level of control is much higher, and the performances are also very different. They are concerned with the light of the traffic light. Is it visible enough, etc.?
You know, it's so interesting. We take so many things for granted out there in the world, you know, that they just work and that they're safe. So are there any other obligatory or required marks for construction products? For instance, I was thinking, is there like a similar worldwide mark that is available or necessary?
Well, as I said, CE marking is a trade law, and it's, the contents are based on safety. And all around the world, countries and regions have their own market access and safety regulations. So there are all kinds of different types of control products. But I do not know of any mark that has the same scope of CE marking, because it gives access with one mark to almost an entire continent, and this is very unique to CE marking.
You know, it's clear to me that CE marking is well known and a trusted mark that is required on certain construction products and other products, of course. Is it possible to get this mark on your product when there's no European harmonized standard for that product?
Yeah, well, there is. So firstly, I have to say that if there is a harmonized standard, then CE marking is obligatory. But there are certainly a lot of products, especially new products, that do not fall under the scope of a harmonized standard, and they do not need to be CE marked. However, the European Union has put in place a procedure so you can have a CE mark voluntarily.
Well, in that case. Super interesting, as if people volunteer for anything, but raises another question. Would we want to start or have a voluntary CE marking procedure in cases where CE marking is not required?
Well, there are certainly advantages to having a voluntary CE mark if it's not mandatory. And the main advantage is that you can cover the whole European market. So if you have a CE mark on your a voluntary CE mark on your product, you still have access to the whole European Union, and you don't have to get access in every individual EU member state that you want to sell your product, which would be the case if you don't have a CE mark.
So let's talk about how difficult the procedure is to get CE marking with a European Technical Assessment, or ETA. What is an ETA, by the way?
ETA is a European Technical Assessment, and that is the term that is used for this voluntary procedure. And concerning the difficulty, that depends greatly on the type of product, because essentially you have to write a new kind of standard or assessment documents, and the more product is similar to existing products, the easier it becomes to write such an assessment document, because you can then use the same kinds of tests and control systems. If you have a very unique product that is very different from existing products, then it may become more difficult.
So in terms of procedure, does a more difficult procedure, a more complicated product, does that take longer to do?
Probably yes, because then in the assessment procedure, that has to be done in the IOT, that's internal European group of institutes, it has to be accepted and Afterwards, the European Commission has to accept it as well. And it takes more time to accept these kinds of documents if you have more new information which has to be processed by these groups.
So it is, it's not for the faint of heart, but it certainly is for the greater good, meaning that by having CE marking regulations in place, it means that we're all safer. Does that make sense to you?
Yes, it makes sense. And it's not only safety, it's also a common understanding. So in Europe, we always talk about the same thing. So it makes the communication on your products easier as well.
Okay, that is amazing. Can you tell me, how can SGS help its clients with CE marking? And feel free to give me as much info as possible, because I'm finding this so interesting.
Okay, excellent. I told that there are two pillars under each CE marking. So okay. There's type testing and there is certification. And for selected products, we can perform these tests and perform certification if necessary for particular CE marks. We can also help with these voluntary CE marks. And my own function, I also help with guidance on CE marking. So I'll help explain to our clients what is necessary for their product and which procedure to follow.
That is amazing. So it's something that's necessary. It's something that people have to do. And you're the expert, which is why I'm so glad you're talking to me today. You know, we're going to get to a bit of a Q&A session at the end of our little chat here. I've got a couple more questions, if you don't mind. And the first one is Brexit. We can't not talk about this development. So can you sort of clear up for me, what are the consequences to the United Kingdom for stepping away from the European Union as far as UK and European trading products are concerned?
Yeah, no problem. It is a very challenging subject to understand because it is fully in progress. But essentially, Great Britain has stepped out of the European common market. So CE marking will in the near future no longer be valid for access to the UK market. And vice versa, they will have a new system which not automatically grants access to the European market. The system is called, that they are developing, is called UKCA, which has the same technical content as the CE marking, but is judicially its own label. So you have to have a UKCA label for access to the British market. You have to have a CE label also if you're from Britain to get access to the European market.
So I understand that there's a bit of a time frame. Can you tell me a little bit about that time frame? So I'm talking about the transition from CE to UKCA.
Yes. Currently, we are in a transition period. And until this week, it was said that at the end of this year, CE marking would no longer be valid and you had to have a UKCA market to have access to the British market. However, just this week, the UK government has informed everybody that this transition period will be extended for another year, just to give people enough time to get things in order, because the end of the year is coming very rapidly.
Yes.
So they have extended the transition period.
So we're talking about 2023, is that right?
Yeah, 1st of January 2023.
It'll be here before we know it.
Yeah, it's so, another year, and a year goes quickly.
Boy, does it ever. So, Peter, how are you feeling? Are you ready to take on some of our audience questions? We've got some great ones.
Yes, please. Bring it on.
Wonderful. Okay, here comes our first question. It will be, there we go, from Fong Lee. Is there any on-site audit required for construction products?
Yeah, but it depends on the product. So auditing is coupled with certification. So in case your quality control procedures have to be certified, then there's an audit necessary. And this is only relevant if your harmonized standard for your product says that it is necessary. So these are high security level products. And if in case that's applicable, then you have this audit requirement.
Oh, that's fantastic. Okay, I just want to remind our audience that if you're interested in submitting a question, put it in the chat below the screen, and we've got our expert Peter Crucq here to answer them. So we've got another question coming up, and that is from Irvin Kavak TP. I hope I pronounced it right. Is there any template or procedure for a client which is to be followed?
Well, there's no single procedure. It starts with an assessment of which product are we talking about and which standard is applicable. And if you have this information readily available, then you can have a template of procedure. Then you know what to do. And any harmonized standard has the basic templates at the end of the standard. It's called an annex set A. That's the last annex to such a standard, which has the basic rules for that product.
So basically, they should just contact SGS and SGS can walk them through the process. Is that fair to say?
If they don't know the standard, we can certainly help to find out which standard is applicable and which procedure to follow. Yes.
There's nothing like dealing with the experts to make things work, that's for sure. I think we've got another question. How do you rate the possible additional labeling from CE mark construction products with the UKCA mark as it conflicts with an article in the CPR? First of all, what
I think, sorry, I didn't catch the last bit of your question.
We're talking about it, that UKCA conflicts with an article in the CPR. First of all, for our audience, what's CPR?
Yeah, exactly. CPR stands for Products Regulation, and that's the EU law that defines all the requirements for CE marking of construction products. CPR says that you can't have conflicting information next to the CE label that is in the CE label. I would assess that UKCA labeling is no issue because it does not concern the harmonized standard and the European market, but it's competition on the UK market and the UK. So I would be hard-pressed to think that it cannot be placed alongside. If that would be the case, then you have to have separate labeling for any product that goes to the UK and a separate labeling for products that go to the European Union, which would be very impractical.
Just another reminder to our audience that I'm going to put up a website close to the end of our show for people to be able to access more information because, you know, information gives us all the opportunity to get done what we need to get done. So right now, what we need to get done is another question. From a LinkedIn user, as a UK company and a US company, who can sign the DOC for CE and UKCA, all those letters, DOC, it's a rapid quiz. What does that stand for?
Yeah, it's actually an old abbreviation. We now use DOP, which stands for a Declaration of Performance. Declaration of Performance is a document which you present as a manufacturer yourself. As soon as you have CE marked your product, and it also contains the information on the manufacturer and the product and the performances. The manufacturer itself has to sign a declaration of performance. It's a declaration of the manufacturer himself.
So it doesn't really matter if it's a UK or a US company. It's whoever is the manufacturer is what is the point.
Yeah, that's at least it is for the CE marking. So declaration of performance is linked to CE marking. Okay. And if you sell it in the European Union, you have to present a declaration of performance to your clients. And that is signed by the manufacturer. Whether you are a UK, US, China, or European company, doesn't matter. Okay. If you want to sell in Europe, you have to sign it as a manufacturer.
Amazing. I think we have another question. So from Maria Diaz Fernandez, are you ready to do CE procedure for RPAS according with new rules from EASA?
Well, I am the expert, but in this case, I do not know exactly what these abbreviations stand for. So maybe that can be cleared up in a minute, and maybe in the meantime, we can talk about another question. So maybe someone can ask the meaning of these abbreviations.
So Maria, if you're still here, please just get back to us with the abbreviations and we'll come back to your question if we have time. In the meantime, here's another question. What are the consequences if I do not correctly CE mark my product?
Well, essentially, you're committing an economic crime. So the consequences can be quite significant. Most of the time, European countries and their agencies who check this give you time to make things in order. But ultimately, a product can be taken from the market. There can be fines. So, crime and punishment, if you will.
Okay. So it's basically serious. You've got to follow the steps and you have to do the correct procedure or else it's to your detriment. I think that that's probably a fair statement. We have an answer to our pass for Maria's question. Maybe we can get Maria's question back because that stands for remotely piloted aircraft system. And EASA, you're on your own.
Well, I think it's difficult for me to answer because if you're talking about remote systems, I don't think we're talking about construction products.
Fair enough. Okay.
So there are probably CE rules on that as well, but I'm not specialized in that. So maybe we can take this question to our colleagues. So I would be inviting us to send this question to the experts on remote products.
Because as you spoke about, CE marking is required for many different kinds of products. I mean, what we're focusing on here are construction products. EASA, just so we all know, European Union Aviation Safety Agency. I wouldn't have come up with that one. So we'll get back to you, Maria, in the comments. We'll find out the answer to your question. And one of my SGS colleagues will definitely get back to you in the comments after that. So let's take a look at one more question. You're doing great, Peter. Were you a little bit concerned that these were going to be tricky?
Well, this last one was a bit tricky, but we'll see. We'll manage.
You're doing great. Who checks and enforces that products are correctly CE marked?
It's the responsibility of individual EU member states to organize this enforcement. Every EU member has to have its own agency, if you will, that will check whether manufacturers and other selling companies comply with EU regulations. So I'm thinking that in every EU member state, there is an agency who polices CE marking.
Okay. We have one final question from our audience, but I will have a follow-up question myself. So get ready. Here we go. Can a product fall under two or more CE regulations?
Yes, it certainly can. Of course, there are some products that do not match. So we're very surprised if there is a product that falls under CE marking of toys and construction products. However, there are examples of products that fall under two CE regulations. In particular, electrical equipment can be combined with certain building products, such as the traffic lights, which I talked about earlier. They do not only need to be safe as a construction product, but also as an electrical product. And you have to make sure that electrical requirements are in order as well.
Okay. I often ask my guests, give them the opportunity to have the last word. So you love what you do, obviously. But can you give us, you know, maybe two or three points that we would like the audience to take away for them to remember about CE marking of construction products?
Well, I certainly hope that I have made a little bit more clear, firstly, what CE marking is, how it is used, and who has to make sure that CE marking is in order. And I also hope that I've given some little insight in the situation between UK and Europe in the current Brexit situation. So these would be certainly be key points to take away from this interview, hopefully.
Do you know what's so fascinating? So many different countries, so many different products, and yet the world sort of comes together and sees safety as the primary issue. Do you think that that's a fair statement?
Everybody's always concerned about safety, and quite rightly so. And I think it's only very fair and very important that if you want to sell products in Europe, you want to make sure that we're talking about the same product, especially in concerning safety. Yes.
Do you know what? You have been an amazing source of information. Oh my goodness, I have learned so much. So I want to thank everybody for joining us for another session of SGS Live. If you have any questions or you're looking for more information about CE marking of construction products, you need to go here, sgs.com/CE mark construction products, and you've got all kinds of information there. I want to thank you, Peter Crucq. You have just made my life so much more interesting and so much easier. Thank you so much for joining me. This has been another SGS Live. I'm PJ Kwong. Bye for now.
Thank you, and bye-bye.